the story of the interstellar comet 3i Atlas, the third interstellar object we've ever detected, continues to develop and evolve, indeed very rapidly now that it's past perihelion, its closest encounter with the sun. Perhaps the biggest development was announced just a few days ago. The Meerkat radio telescope in South Africa detected a kind of radio signal from 3i Atlas, but it's not aliens, it's chemistry. This will surely excite those proposing an alien technological origin for the object, but the signature is actually far from that, and actually bad news for an artificial origin hypothesis. Comets do this, and it can't be used to suggest an alien origin for this object. The emissions are absorption lines in radio caused by hydroxyl, or HO. This is a fingerprint of a comet, and probably also means the object is shedding a lot of water. And there had already been hints of hydroxyl from data gathered by NASA's Neil Gerald Swift Observatory, and this new Meerkat finding simply confirms it. The new observations were obtained by Meerkat on October 24th, just days after Atlas's closest approach to the sun. The hydroxyl lines were detected at the radio frequencies of 1.665 and 1.667 GHz, and revealed Doppler shifts of -15.59 and -15.65. This is normal for an object moving and being observed by an object also in motion, Earth, right when Atlas was very close to the plane of the solar system. Meerkat had tried in September to see this expected effect from the comet, but was not successful. But this type of radio emission is not what you would see from a SETI signal or communication of any type. It's just too ambiguous and honestly normal. This is a natural emission and absorption by hydrogen compounds. Indeed, the infamous 1420 MHz hydrogen line in SETI is related here. It's the frequency that neutral hydrogen emits in radio. Look at a hydrogen cloud in the galaxy and you see it. This is like that. It's natural noise, but it's also signpost frequency, because aliens will know of that frequency if they are doing astronomy. And if you want to say hello to someone, you need that signpost. Otherwise, you're randomly picking a frequency out of nowhere, one of millions upon millions, and just randomly throwing it out there, and that drops your likelihood of ever being picked up by anyone. They may simply not be tuning on the dial to where you are broadcasting. We, and aliens, can completely miss signals if we're listening on the wrong channel. Signposts fix that, and indeed hydroxyl combines with hydrogen to form water. The net effect of this is that the area of the spectrum between 1420 MHz and 1662 MHz also is unusually quiet in most other ways. The radio gets absorbed by the gas clouds. Unless your signal is artificial, then it can scream. And anyone doing science will know about this effect and wonder if someone is broadcasting there. But the hydroxyl line is also one such signpost. That whole window is called the waterhole for a reason. But for 3i Atlas, this is not that type of signal. This is nature. There will be another attempt at studying the object in radio, however. Some more developments should come on this front soon. On March 16th of next year, the object will pass about 53 million kilometers from Jupiter. At that time, the Juno spacecraft can make a specific observation. There was some talk of sending Juno out to directly intercept 3i Atlas, but it turns out Juno's main engine has become unreliable with age, and it just doesn't have the fuel reserves. However, it can make a radio observation from Jupiter with its dipole antenna and search for signals at low frequencies when the object is closest to it, from 50 to 40 MHz. And reveal even more about the chemistry of the object, which is of specific interest because it's from another star system entirely. There has also been much talk about how the data from the Mars probes is not yet in, leading to conspiracy theories regarding the data from the probes being intentionally hidden or withheld by NASA. This actually has a much more prosaic explanation. It was the US government shutdown, and the fact that the scientists involved with those missions couldn't do anything with the data. They were quite literally locked out of the building due to the Congressional Anti-Deficiency Act in the US. So now, as the shutdown ends, they will get back to work, and we will see those results fairly quickly. That also affects the activities of some of the European probes, because most missions at Mars are multinational cooperations with teams in the US, and the missions require them for dealing with the data. So basically, a lot of things were on ice until the end of the shutdown, which seems to be over. However, the data was taken by all the spacecraft. It's there. So we will have significantly more, including new images, of 3I Atlas in the not-too-distant future. The images from the high-rise camera on the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter will be particularly revealing, as it will, with any luck, allow the scientists to figure out the actual size of the object's nucleus, which has been somewhat elusive so far and not well constrained. One other major development is that 3I Atlas has, as of November 9th, developed a stronger tail. It continues to display the anti-tail spike that it had for some time, but now sports a very spotty, basically smoky-looking trail that's a bit peculiar. Not too far out of the ordinary for a comet, but unusual, and speaks to this object not being from these parts. The nucleus is now also showing multiple jets, about 7, and is experiencing some puzzling features that may or may not indicate that 3I Atlas broke apart at its perihelion. That's still developing, though new data from the Nordic Optical Telescope suggests strongly that it did not break up. Had it happened though, which would have been interesting, it would give us a really good insight on what this comet is made of. Comets breaking up is not rare to see. We see comets breaking up in gravitational interactions a lot. A famous example of this was Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, that was broken up some time before its plunge into Jupiter through gravitational interactions, and the fragments all came in as a train of material. Comets really are loose conglomerations of ice and rock, a lot of dust, and they are really delicate. Heat them up and get them in a high gravity environment, and they can fall apart. 3I Atlas never got too close to the sun, so it was possible, but a little unlikely. This fragmentation leads to a lot more ice sublimating due to more surface area being exposed to the sun, which can cause the effects that are being seen. But it can also happen if the object is still holding together and enough new reservoirs of volatiles come available during the pass from the heat and start outgassing, which seems to be where this is going. So it remains to be seen whether it really broke up or remained intact and just became very active, but the indication so far is that it remained intact. That one I suspect will be settled pretty quickly, as the object is now observable again, with difficulty, by both amateur and professional telescopes suited for the task. It is not observable yet with Hubble or James Webb, because those telescopes have robust zones of avoidance. They can't point too close to the sun, or they risk burning their instruments out by the overpowering light of the sun. They are built for sensitivity and really dim objects, not bright ones. Also observed just before perihelion was a major overall brightening of Atlas. It also turned from a green color to blue, which signifies some kind of change in what chemicals it was outgassing. If it had broken up, the tidal forces of the sun, however, would separate out the fragments over time, and the new data suggests this is not happening. But it's an interesting topic in and of itself. Strangely, perhaps, the more we have learned about cometary disintegrations in recent years may have given us an insight on another mystery in science. A real enigma from long ago. The infamous Tunguska event of 1908. For many years it has been debated just what the nature of that object was, and it's still unclear today. All we know is that it entered Earth's atmosphere over Siberia and exploded as an airburst, really violently, so as to burn and flatten an enormous amount of forest when it struck. Worse than the nuclear bombs used in World War II. One theory was that rather than an asteroid, it may have been a fragment of a comet, specifically Comet Encke, because the blast occurred at the same time as the Earth was passing through Comet Encke's path, which comet paths are usually what cause our annual meteor showers. It's the shorn debris of the comet in its orbit of the sun left from its tail that Earth predictably cooks through in its own orbit. It's like passing through a cloud. Something we might in the future be able to go look at with 3I Atlas. It's leaving a trail behind it. But if comets really are that delicate, something that wasn't well understood when the comet theories for Tunguska were prominent, then it becomes unlikely to have been a comet because it survived so deeply into the Earth's atmosphere before it exploded. So it seems to push further into the direction that was a small asteroid, as we've learned how delicate comets are. If you call something 65 meters wide, small. But just what kind of asteroid remains a mystery, as does what exactly happened to it. Asteroids that large usually always drop meteorites, and nothing has ever been found for Tunguska other than grains of potential meteoritic origin, some embedded in burned tree bark, and chemical evidence of metals like iridium that are hallmarks of meteorites. Here there are studies that have been done, but yielded conflicting results. It pays to point out that Tunguska is very remote, out in the Siberian forests, and to this day not hugely well studied on site. Few people have ever lived in the area, and in fact, as far as I know, it's still possible that the area is still littered with meteorites, but no one has found them yet. As a result, there are studies that suggest an iron meteorite did it, but there's a problem. Iron is tough, and if you look at a comparable sized object that was an iron asteroid, Meteor Crater in Arizona and the corresponding Canyon Diablo iron meteorites, you see that it did not only whack the ground directly and not completely explode in the air or vaporize, it showered iron meteorite fragments everywhere, in addition to creating vaporized particles of nickel iron that condensed and fell as a kind of metal rain in the area immediately after. These can still be found in the Arizona desert around there. And that might be true for Tunguska as well. It's just that no one has found the right places for it, perhaps. No one knows. Another one that did something similar was the Sakodialin meteorite that also hit Russia in 1947. It exploded very low. In fact, it literally went off like a grenade just before it hit a mountainside and sprayed iron space shrapnel everywhere that you can buy online. But nothing like this has ever been found for Tunguska. And it's not hard to find iron meteorites if you have a metal detector. The alternative is a stone meteorite having done it. But again, exploding stone meteorites throw fragments everywhere. Just look at the spectacularly dangerous Chelyabinsk, also Russia, meteorite that exploded in 2013 and injured over 1,000 people, largely from shattering window glass from the blast concussion. It blew fragments of itself everywhere on snow, making the many thousands of dark meteorite fragments easy to find and retrieve. But nothing but chemical traces were ever found for Tunguska. But that's also much more difficult terrain to get to and to search than Chelyabinsk is. Incidentally, the reason Russia gets hit by so many meteorites is its enormous landmass. The ocean gets much more activity, but unless you're out on a ship, many of those do not get seen by anything but satellites and seismographs. But multiple kiloton or even megaton level blasts happen relatively commonly over the water. Less so over land, but when you have the vastness of Russia, you are a larger target for meteorites, so you will see more of them. But recovering them from remote forest land like where Tunguska is less likely. Interestingly, if Tunguska had been a few minutes earlier in its entry, it would have hit the more populated US and Canada, probably around the border. Watch out, Minnesota and Ontario. In places like North America, meteorites are more commonly found, or were, not because of landmass, but agriculture. Farmers would find strange rocks, often by hitting them with plows, get them out of their fields so they don't hit them again, and just put them somewhere in the yard until they got recognized by someone years later as a meteorite that might have fallen centuries before or even longer. There was even a case in Mexico where the farmer found a large iron meteorite with a plow, knew it was weird and bowl-shaped, and set it aside and used it as a dog bowl for decades before it was recognized. But a comet might fit the bill for Tunguska, but with comets turning out to be so flimsy, that's getting less likely. Maybe there are constitutionally stronger comets than others, perhaps. We just don't know. Anyway, back to Atlas. Another thing to update since my last video is that the object has also shown the first evidence of non-gravitational changes in speed. Now, what happens here, and what made the first interstellar object, Oumuamua, so strange, is that as you heat a cometary object to the point of shooting out jets of gas, that acts as a thruster, like a rocket, independent of the effects of gravity and light pressure on motion from the sun. This is now being observed with 3I Atlas pretty clearly, but with it having all those jets coming off it, it's not surprising or out of the ordinary. Oumuamua had no detectable jets, yet still showed an acceleration of unknown origin that has never been satisfactorily explained. That has to be said. But there are some gases that can come from comets that we have no ready way of detecting. That has to be remembered. But with 3I Atlas, with all those jets, it's normal. The jets are simply pushing it around randomly like thrusters. And the smoky-looking nature of the object's tail might be due to its rotation. There isn't a good handle on that. But it might be outgassing when deposits of volatile ice are in sunlight, and then stop outgassing when they are in shade. We'll know more soon, and the data from the various probes gets processed. But on the alien front, in regards to this object, it always pays to remember one thing. With close aliens, if they want to hide, you will never see them at all, or even know they are there, unless they want you to. But if they don't want to hide, you will immediately know it when you see it, and it will be overwhelmingly obvious. What it won't do is partly disguise itself as a highly scientifically interesting comet. There it gains attention, no matter what. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently adjusting to the sputtering onset of winter here. It can't make up its mind if it wants to be warm or freezing cold so far this year, and it's wreaking havoc on my voice, as I'm sure you can hear. It'll get better when the weather makes up its mind, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.